Good morning, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us today. I'm Angie Newsom with Carolina Public Press. I'm the director, and I'm just going to tell you a little bit about what's going to happen today and who we are. Carolina Public Press, we are an online nonprofit news organization. So we focus on in-depth and investigative reporting on issues that are really important to Western North Carolina, public interest issues such as education, the environment, the economy, state and local politics, etc. So if you haven't checked us out, please do. We're at carolinapublicpress.org. We're really happy to have all of you, both y'all that are here and those of you who are joining us online through our live stream. So this is the first time we're live streaming an event. Really excited to be able to offer that to people who can't and perhaps don't want to drive to Asheville this early in the morning, but still want to participate. So what's going to happen today is that Frank Taylor, who's our managing editor, is going to moderate our panelists, a conversation with our panelists for about 30, 35 minutes or so, and then we'll open it up for Q&A from all of you who are here. And those of you who are with us remotely, post to our Facebook page or tweet us or post on to our page at carolinapublicpress.org, and we'll be monitoring all of those and hopefully get those questions answered as well. So thank you again for coming, and let me introduce you.
I'm making sure our phones don't go
off. Right. We have a saying in our office that's like, phones on. News never stops. Okay, so Alan Nicholas, who we're really excited to welcome him both to Western North Carolina and to welcome him today. He's the Forest Supervisor with the U.S. Forest Service here in Asheville, but he covers all the forests in North Carolina. Director Roderick Simmons, he's with Asheville Parks and Rec, so we have a local representative for some of the local public lands that are here in Asheville. And Gordon Warburton, who's the Ecoregion Supervisor with the North Carolina Wildlife Resources Commission. We're very excited to have these three amazing gentlemen with us today. They're very knowledgeable, so go for it. Ask them the hard questions. So thank you again, and I will probably signal Frank when it's time for y'all to ask questions. So thank you again for being here. Frank, and this is Frank Taylor.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Angie. Well, I just want to add a little bit to what Angie was telling you about Carolina Public Press in relation to the issue. The issues we're going to be addressing today regarding public lands. Jack Eigelman has really been our lead reporter on a lot of public lands issues, particularly looking at the federal level as we have an ongoing process with the Forestry Service developing master plans for the two national forests in Western North Carolina right now. Jack is not able to be with us today, but he has a major report coming out next week that I encourage you to look forward to, and he'll be looking at resolutions that counties and towns have passed expressing their will on what the future federal wilderness management in Western North Carolina should look like. And I think that'll be a very fascinating piece to those who are interested in these land management issues. I also will be working on a piece that should be coming out, one piece will be coming out next week, I believe, and some within the next month, looking at a local park. It's not in Asheville, but it's a telling situation about how local parks can matter, not always in a positive way. There's some controversy over a park in one of our surrounding counties. And when we begin to ask questions about their use of federal money and about the correspondence that's gone on in creating this park, they got some substantial state and federal grants, we discovered that people were omitting their emails, which is not really a good thing to see in local officials. So we'll be reporting on that, and we're talking with our lawyer about recurring those public records that are being withheld right now. So as we get into these public lands issues, we expect Carolina Public Press to continue to report on issues like these and surrounding these over time. I do want to tell everybody, you all may be aware, our site crashed pretty badly about a week ago, and we're back up. So if you had stopped checking because we were not working well, we were sluggish and then just died, we're back. And would invite everybody to go take a look at what we've been doing. We had some reporting this week that I think everybody will find interesting on new developments in the debate over the effect of coal ash on public health. and we've also done some additional reporting on education and other issues. As I talked to each of you, we introduced you by name, but could each of you tell us a little bit about yourselves, what you do, and then just go across the panel? Gordon, start with Gordon.
Yes, my name is Gordon Warburton, and I am the Mountain Ecoregion Supervisor. And so the ecoregion we're talking about basically with the Wildlife Commissioner is the western 22 counties. And I know I don't look this old, but I've been working for the Wildlife Commission for 34 years. And all of that, I have been great fortune to live in Marion, North Carolina, through all the different things that I've done. And most of my career has been spent with the land conservation, land management side of the equation, although I did a brief stint in the middle for 10 years as the Black Bear Project Leader for the state. And I went to North Carolina State University for my master's degree, and I studied bears just below here in the Pisgah Ranger District near Brevard. And my claim to fame is that I was the first person in the state of North Carolina in 1981 to put a radio collar on a black bear in the state. And now in Asheville, we've got 40 of these things, but I started the whole thing. So you can blame me for the bears or give me credit for the bears. But so now as an ecoregion supervisor, I've been doing that since about 1998, and I administer our game lands program, boating access areas, and other public use facilities associated with the Wildlife Commission. And when I started out, we had about maybe 10 or 11,000 acres of game, state-owned game lands, and now we're up over 100,000 acres of state-owned areas. And the really exciting part, you look back on your career, I'm not going anywhere, but you look back on your career and you know, what are the things that you've done that mattered? And to me, the Wildlife Commission has been an amazing player in the conservation, the landscape conservation puzzle. And when the land conservancies are looking for somebody needs to take this land, and well, we can't because of this, I'll give it to the Wildlife Commission, they'll take it. And we have, and we've got the land before we got the people and all the thing, but we're like, the land, you've got to move with the land. And so we are the largest state government landowner here, and we've got 500,000 acres of game lands, state-owned game lands in the state. So, but we've really been very, very happy to and proud to be a major player in the conservation puzzle. And so I've got a lot of folks out here, and of course the major game land for us is cooperating with the United States Forest Service, and I won't steal any of Alan's material here, but we've been a long time cooperator with the U.S. Forest Service on all of their Forest Service lands, and we have agreements to cooperatively manage the wildlife resources on the federal lands, and we respect each other's purveys, but we work together to try to do the best job we can for fish and wildlife resources on the Forest Service lands.
Well, Roderick Simmons, I didn't wrestle bears or collar.
We can arrange that.
Just a municipal employee. Roderick Simmons, as I said, I've worked in local government for 26 years. I've been in Asheville for the last 9. I've worked at the city of High Point, the city of Fayetteville, Sampson County, and now in the mountains. And this is probably by far my favorite place to work. If I'd have known that, I'd have been here a long time ago. Kind of what we do, we provide municipal recreation services, which is a little different than the federal services, but we have 70 facilities, 54 more public parks. So a city our size, we have a tremendous amount of public space that's used by the community that we manage. We have the Nature Center, we have the golf course with McCormick Field, we have 7 community centers, we have 3 swimming pools, and 2 regional parks, Carey Park and Azalea Park. Those are our big ones. So we manage a lot of public space, trying to provide those quality of life things that citizens enjoy. We also have greenway trails that go throughout the city. Part of our struggle has been we're not able to expand anymore with annexation, leaving the city. So the land that we have now, we have to manage because we can't expand our boundaries, which that puts kind of pressure on the tax base. So deciding what properties come off from development versus what stays public recreational areas to enjoy is a struggle for us with that. But we also work with Buncombe County and a lot of community groups. We work with Riverlink and Greenworks and a lot of the local groups to be able to provide sustainable environment. So that's pretty much the basis of our program.
Good morning, I'm Alan Nicholas. I'm the Forest Supervisor for the National Forest in North Carolina. That would include the Nantahala, Pisgah, the Uwharrie, and the Croatan over on the coast. So kind of a long, got a lot of pieces of ground scattered between here and in the coast. Basically, when you think about my job, I'm an administrator. I'm responsible for the management of people, personnel, and projects, working in coordination and partnership with a wide variety of NGOs. I come to you from Southern Illinois, where I was there for 13 years, and my experiences kind of carried me through the Southeast and Mississippi, South Carolina, and kind of gave me a variety of opportunities to work with folks. So this is month two for me. I've had a lot of opportunity to meet a lot of great folks, the stakeholder forum, and several of you individually on discussing different opportunities here in North Carolina. Big land base, a lot of opportunities, a lot of expectations relative to delivery of both services and recreational opportunities. And so it's been a lot of fun. I've enjoyed my time here to date, and I look forward to meeting y'all and continue to work as we manage the National Forest lands here in North Carolina.
Very good. Roderick, I didn't know you had been in Fayetteville until last year. I was working with the Federal Observer, and I have to say I'm also very happy to be in Asheville, having spent some time.
Exactly. You know exactly that.
Each of you touched on this a little bit, but I want to come back and go through the panel again and ask this question. In addition to what you do on a day-to-day basis, what aspects of your job do you see as the biggest challenges that you have to face on a regular basis?
You know, Roderick and I were talking a little bit earlier, and at least for me, and based on our conversation, it's probably very similar. It's trying to meet expectations. There is such a wide variety of opportunities, use, and all these things have some level of trying to provide space, time, and money to be able to support these things. So for me, I think that's trying to meet the expectations and managing and where necessary preserving the resources that we're in charge of managing.
Yeah, I think that's, I echo you completely in terms of trying to manage public space, especially in an urbanized area, because we just don't really have a lot of, we have competing needs. And how do you create situations where you don't have win-lose, but it's a win-win? So bringing everybody to the table and having cooperative agreements and trying to work together to sustain the community is a challenge, because you have individual agendas with different organizations. So how do you blend those to provide for a better quality community is a challenge for us.
Well, we have lots of challenges too, but you know, I think one of our biggest challenges is trying to explain to the public, you know, why we do what we do, and a lot of this comes down to why do we have to manage and do these things. People mention the word management and administrate and all these things, and I think you know, I mentioned all the lands that we acquired, and we were getting these lands and. We drew the boundaries around them, and then we started looking inside of the boundaries, and we began seeing the many, many challenges that we face, because we have to go inside there and look at wildlife habitat. These are the places where wildlife live, and if we don't have those habitats or a diversity of those habitats, then the wildlife are not going to be there, or they're going to be there, or they're going to be in trouble. And we started looking, and we saw all of these invasive plants coming into our forest communities and of all descriptions. We are looking at some of these areas that we got, and they weren't in good shape. The folks that maybe had them beforehand were cutting the wrong kinds of trees, and the stands were not in good shape. And you know, we're already down on the chestnut. The chestnut's missing and missing components, and the hemlock is another thing. So all of these things, in some cases, these challenges to the forest. Rare habitats and things, you want to leave those things alone. Some of these require that we do things. And we, you know, sometimes we've made mistakes in the past, but we want to, you know, we want to do things to help make these areas better than we found them. And so the word restoration comes up, and I think that's one of our challenges. We've got these big areas, and everyone's using them, and the wildlife's trying to use them, and so just trying to get the message to the public that we're out here trying to do some things, we're out here trying to manage, and sometimes it might look a little dirty or something, but we're trying to actually, it's like refurbishing your house for a while. It's not going to look very good. But then when you get done, it's like, holy smokes. And we hope it's the holy smokes thing at the end of it. But you know, just trying to get the message to the public that we're trying to use the best science and scientific forestry to, and other things. And fire is another example. A lot of these places, fire had been suppressed for a century, and that has had some major impacts too. And so just trying to transmit messages to the public that we've got to take care of these lands, and sometimes that's an active process, sometimes that's a passive process, and it's a blend of things. So
one of the things that we've been hearing as we've looked a lot at the federal forestry issues, but I know that some of these hold true for the state and local parks as well, is there seems to be a divide. I don't know if it's among the scientists or perhaps between the scientists and some of the advocacy groups over the appropriate policy with regard to what is going to do the best for maintaining healthy habitat over time. With regard to things like fire and so on, there are some who advocate for controlled burns and for really close human management, and others who advocate for really having a very hands-off approach to keeping things natural and the natural order. There seems to be a tension, and perhaps both sides have some good points. Is that something each of you see as you look at policymaking, that there is this tension out there among what is the best way to go?
Yeah, I think in the management of public lands, be it urban or state or federal, I think there is often quite a variety of opinions on what should happen where.
Yeah.
And so it's through the planning process that this forest and the stakeholder group, which I would diverge just a minute and tell you how impressed I am with the level of commitment and investment that the stakeholder forum has made here in North Carolina relative to the revision of the forest plan. It is amazing. So yes, you'll often find differences of opinion, differences of approach, and so it's the best science. Gordon and I have talked about this a little bit. You know, trying to find and apply the best science in the best places, and as far as our management allocations of land, there will be places we will do, you know, direct work that would have some level of disturbance necessary to maintain these systems. Other places, there's going to be places where we won't do anything relative to wilderness and some of these other standards where natural processes continue. So it really gives a variety of people different places to go in order to experience the things that they want to see. But yeah, there will always be a degree of difference of opinion, I believe.
Yeah, that was just more of how we manage it in terms of being in an urban environment. You know, do we use pesticides, in what areas do we use pesticides, or do we just let it grow naturally and not try to manage it as much? So a lot of it is right-of-way issues too. Where do we plant edibles? You know, how do we maintain the edible gardens? And when citizens see areas as growing up, but it's a natural where people are growing edibles, but they're like, you need to maintain that. It needs to be cut because you have different generations that look at things differently. You know, some like things to be manicured, some like things just to be natural. If you can go around Asheville, you can see that in different yards and how people maintain it. So that's been our issue, is how do we maintain public space, because we have two different philosophies on what it should look like and how it should be maintained and then what should be allowed in those spaces.
Yeah, I think, you know, one thing I've learned over the years, when you've had these many years, you can say over the years. So anyway, and one thing I've learned over the years is that, and I've done some work in conservation work in South America and other places too, but the common element is that successful conservation is based, working with local folks, the people that are living in a particular area. You need to have that support. So, you know, when you're making these decisions, some of these are social decisions, and there's nothing wrong with that, and human objectives and things. And so these, you know, just responding to the local folks and working with local, getting local support on these things is very, very important.
Very good. Alan, I want to direct a question to you and give a little background, and you can correct me if I have some of my facts wrong on this, because this is where Jack has been doing a lot of our reporting, and I've been following it some. But we have this ongoing process as the master plans are being developed for the Nantahala and Pisgah National Forest. And Jack has reported on some of the tensions, even though the stakeholders process has been very progressive and positive in many respects. There have been tensions that have erupted over some of these issues where people have honest disagreements. And there was a particular issue that arose earlier this year when a core group advocated for, I'm trying to remember what it was called. You may be able to, the designation they wanted to go for on some of these areas that were being considered for potential wilderness. You know what I'm referencing?
I think that happened slightly before I got here, but I think perhaps there was an MOU developed and there were some other discussions about some other allocations that have, and that name absolutely escapes me, I'm sorry.
But it was a special designation that would have put these lands into a category. It wasn't wilderness. And so in a way,
National Recreation Area.
Yes, National Recreation Areas, yeah. And so this was going to put these lands that are already part of the National Forest into a special level of protection, but a different level than the wilderness level. What happened among the stakeholders is some of them were not involved in that MOU, and so feelings were hurt. And some stakeholders said, you know, I don't feel like I have the trust that I had for the process as a result of that. So that's been one thing that's been going on behind the scenes. The other thing that's been happening at the same time as they've been working on this process, a number of cities and counties have weighed in and said, we have a resolution. We do not want to see any more of our area being designated as wilderness in particular. I don't know if they've all responded on the national recreation areas. And I believe we had at least one municipality, if I remember, that went the other way and said, no, we want to see aggressive protection. And so you're getting different messages. I guess I'm interested in an update on where things stand. When can we expect to see the draft report come out? And then I'm just curious about, how all these different voices are factoring into the process.
Yeah, so this is my second time through a land management process. And once again, I want to say how the foresight and using the 2012 planning rule and how this forest has adopted it using the stakeholder forum to generate ideas and kind of start looking at this spectrum of opinion and wants and desires from these two forests as we kind of go to completion. So yeah, from my previous experience, and like I say, I've been here a couple months and had an opportunity to attend two of the stakeholder forums, and the opinions are very wide. And so what you see in these processes sometimes is there can be conversations had, paper generated, numbers will come out of these things, and people will latch onto these, and there will be, and sometimes they may be intended to relay one message, or perhaps they're misunderstood. So it's the communication around this that can get highly varied, and people can get somewhat polarized on various pieces of this business. So I know there's resolutions that have come out. I know that both at the county and perhaps at the city level. And I think that's absolutely part of the process. And so what we have folks is that they want continued access at the current rate. No longer they don't want any kind of infringement on their ability for access or these other things that perhaps they've been doing for many years. And I'm kind of guessing on that piece because I would like an opportunity to meet with the counties or a subset of them to have a discussion to try to figure out, okay, tell me what the issues are, at least from their perspective, because it gives me a basis to at least understand, you know, where people are, what their wants and desires are, and what the deliverables are relative to the plan revision. So the stakeholders have met several times, and these are six-hour sessions, at least the ones I've been to, and there are a lot of wants and desires, opinions, and needs. And the great thing about this is that when you look at the land base in this forest planning effort, you're looking at roughly 80% agreement on what should happen on various pieces of ground. It's not terribly skewed. There are a few pieces, and perhaps Gordon will speak to this at some point, that there is a different desire to see different status or uses placed on land. And so it's really kind of exciting to me that you're in perhaps around an 80% total on rough agreement on the bulk of it, but you have a small percent, 20 to 17, that people really have strident positions on that I'm very hopeful. And I do believe this, is that at the end game, when we kind of get to the draft, that when the draft does come out, there's really going to be no surprises about what we thought, what we've considered, both data, opinion, and to some level position, because you have to understand it's in the planning thing, you can get a boatload of people that have one opinion, but this is not a voting type of process. So you're really looking at the issues, you're weighing them out, you're developing a series of alternatives that depict all the different ideas associated with this planning effort. You'll do an analysis on it, and you'll come to some decision. So backing up what you asked me a minute ago, the forum has been working very hard, just a fantastic process, very, very inclusive with some varying ideas about where things ought to happen. So we've taken that data. The planning team has taken and built some, is in this repetitive or iterative nature of taking information and providing information back out to the team and on the public on our website to be able to kind of show this process we're using. So we've taken all this stuff, and what we're going to do in May is really kind of do a sensing with the group and start trying to chart a path that will get us to draft. Making sure we're honoring everything that we've seen, making sure we're validating the points. But at that point in time, we really have to start setting a course to get to draft. And there will be a process. This process is also iterative. So as this thing develops, we'll still be taking information. We'll still be doing analysis and canvassing the gang here, and as well as anybody else that wants to contribute to get to a draft plan that represents as broad a spectrum of the wants and desires of the folks in this part of the world to see what they want in the next forest plan. Because this needs to be a real success for all of us. There is a great need to expand on the level of management that we do for a wide variety of reasons. There's also a lot of need to look at some of the highest and best sites or areas that are left in the East to give them their due shift relative to evaluation for wilderness. And so it's all part of this whole process.
By East, you mean the Eastern United States?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Yeah.
And so so it's just all part of that. It's all part of the process.
Very good. Do you have a target date for the draft?
Ballpark, let's say fall, somewhere in there. Probably okay. Be good. You know, good. I won't give you a week.
No, I understand.
Because it will change. It's already changed.
Highly probable. This is a complex process, and so you have to be thorough, and you just make sure that you're representing everything. And so yeah, we're a lot more focused on content than we are on date. But this thing does have an end state, so we got to get there.
Well, in fairness to the U.S. Forest Service, there's a 2012 planning rule. This is a brand new rule for plans,
yeah.
And this is one of the first forests to do it. And so they're feeling their way around and trying to invent things. And so
yeah, that's a good point, Gordon. Thank you.
And if I understand correctly, some of the rules were changed. They were pretty far along in the process, and some of the rules changed, and they needed to go back and adapt some new policies as they were working on this.
You know, that's a piece that I'm a little uninformed on.
Okay.
The forest plan that I was working on was under a different planning rule.
Right.
And so what's happened, at least to me, is when I was on my way to North Carolina, I'm trying to get up to speed on the 12 rule. And so James Malonis is the deputy for National Forest in North Carolina. Him and the team have done a tremendous job of leading and guiding this effort. And I may have to go back and talk to him and get with you a little later on that.
I want to ask Gordon a question about something you mentioned in passing. You were talking about the health of some of the forests in particular. We've seen concerns certainly with chestnut and with hemlock. And we've also seen some concerns with animal species. It was interesting. I was working in another part of the state last year. I was seeing a lot of press releases come out regarding the health of aquatic species in the mountains. And one of the concerns was that humans, very inadvertently, were contributing to, could contribute to the spread of health problems for our species, just in the way we're talking about people fishing primarily, and the way they mishandled their lines or carried contamination from one stream to another, that type of thing. That's very frustrating. It seems like you want to work with the public, but you potentially have the public damaging the very parts of the natural habitat that they're appreciating and enjoying. What tools do you have other than just trying to get the word out to try to combat that kind of thing?
Yeah, so disclaimer, I am a terrestrial wildlife
biologist. Understood.
Okay, I do the bears and all the things and the birds and all these things, and so I like the water and I fish, but I obviously work with our fish folks, but this is something that I'm going to extend to the terrestrial area too. So, but no, we've got a series of issues, and I usually don't use notes because I think, but I'm going to use a few of these. But in our reservoirs, hydrilla, white perch, alewife, blueback, herring, spotted bass. These are some issues that are caused by people actually moving fish around. So they're taking this fish and they get done with the bait thing at the end of the day and they dump the bucket into the water and all of a sudden we've got something that doesn't belong there. Cold water, had some three serious diseases now with our trout and our cold water is whirling disease, which got some press just recently here. The gill lice, which we've never had in North Carolina, and we don't even know a lot about this thing here, and didymo, which is an algae, and it's in the Tuckasegee, just to give you an idea of what this stuff looks like, the common name is rock snot. It's not like, okay, so you've got a visual on that algae. It's not like a bear, it's not very charismatic. But no, when these things hit, especially the cold water things, the first thing that we have to do as natural resource managers is to understand the organism and just basic information. Where is it? How far is it? So the first thing with the whirling disease, we're all over the streams. We're sampling every there. We're working with partners and things to figure this out. The gill lice actually trying to figure out what species we have. There's several subspecies of this thing, and so we got to figure out who do we have here and where are they. And so we've done a lot of that work with just finding out where they are and just trying to advance the science on these critters. But once we do get the locational information, and this is sort of the stage we're at now. We have a combination of education and regulations and planning, and so those three things come in. First of all, our fisheries folks are going all over the place, all the barbecue huts, and giving programs to people, and be careful with this stuff, don't move this stuff. This is what's going on. This is how you recognize it. We now require anyone putting any fish or stocking any fish into the waters of North Carolina, we're requiring the permit. So we get to review that. They've got to show us and our staff that these things are disease free. So we can't have the stuff being put out and authorize that. And the third thing is our plan for, what are we calling this? This is the Aquatic Nuisance Species Management Plan. And if you go to ncwildlife.org, we've got that plan up there. And so a lot of this has to do with the reservoirs, but we're using our website as a big source of information. But yeah, it's a matter of, people are sort of causing some of these things, and so we've got to, it's getting the word out to, you're hurting the thing that you love, the thing that you like to do. This does, as I mentioned, it actually transfers to the terrestrial environment, and, white nose syndrome on our bats. And so you go into the cave, and you're looking around, but then this fungus gets on your clothes, you go into another cave, and then you're spreading this fungus, and it's decimating a lot of different bat populations. Just when we had bats, and we were really feeling good about bats, and now a lot of our cave dwellers are not doing very well. And so when we do any of our work, we go in, it looks like a hazmat EPA sort of restoration thing. We go in there with the suits, and when we get out, everything is decontaminated. We go through a huge process when we're just doing our own basic research and things. Same with our fisheries operations. Everything is clean. So we've got very strict protocols for us not causing the problem too. So, people bringing in firewood from different areas. This was another topic that was out here. And again, sounds like that's a tree issue, but for wildlife, trees can be important there. So. People bringing just something as simple as firewood or landscaping with exotics and bringing those in. And it's sort of like the globalization of our species. This stuff is, because we're so mobile now, all these things are moving around, and we're getting all of this stuff popping up. We don't even mention a lot of the diseases that are occurring. A lot of these from other continents that are coming here, and they're taking out hemlocks, for example. The second great ecological catastrophe that's occurring here. So this is all, these are all very challenges, and it comes, like you say, from people inadvertently or advertently moving things around and bringing stuff in and not thinking about it.
I know from my worked in Florida for newspapers there for a while. I'm very familiar with invasive species there.
You've got everything there. You go to southern Florida, you have everything.
Yeah. When you have the anacondas wrestling with the cobras, you've got a problem.
They're taking each other. They're taking each other out, maybe. I don't know.
Yeah. In any case, we can see that that's a concern. Obviously, it's not just happening at the state level. A lot of the publicity on these issues happens at the state level. But I know from what I've been reading about local parks, Invasive species, whether you're talking flora, fauna, can be a big concern in local parks, and I'm sure they're concerned in federal lands as well.
Yeah, I mean, we have 800 acres that we manage throughout the city, parks, right? About 300 of it is wooded areas where we have a lot of canopy and those issues. So we try to partner with community groups because, as you know, the city parks and recreation, we have limited staff. So we try to rely on the community and experts in the community to help us develop management plans and look at how we can manage our land so that we can keep them in good shape and get help with that. So it's kind of a partnership thing with us to be able to manage it.
Are they going in and trying to work with you in managing, you know, say an invasive species takes root, they're going in looking for those and trying to remove them?
Yeah, we because we have limited staff, we try to rely on partnership and agreements to do that. So they'll go in and actually we'll come up with a management plan that we both sign off of. Richmond Hill is an example. Richmond Hill is one of the largest park areas we have. It's 70 acres. We have a disc golf course out there and a mountain biking course. So we partner with different groups and a lot of environmentalists and professors over at UNCA has helped us develop a management plan for that to look at how we manage that site. So it's limited in scope compared to what these guys do. We still have those areas in the city and we try to come up with a best plan to manage them.
So invasives. I just think it's one of the biggest ecological game changers we're gonna see in the next 30, 40 years. I don't have a lot of field time in North Carolina, so I'm kind of leaning on some previous experience, but we'll see species that are completely dominating understories within forest types that we all hold dear. And so you can see lack of the ability for reproduction, direct loss of plants that are currently in place. And to me, it's a daunting thing to think about the numbers of acres these things are going to occupy, whether they're state or local or federal, because if you think about the ability for these things to reoccur, if you look at seabed viability, Microstegium, Japanese steelgrass, which I'm reasonably sure y'all have in this part of the country, you're looking at seabeds that are 7-8 years old. So breaking that cycle and keeping those things from recurring at the end of that cycle, you're talking huge investments of time and money. And so the things that, unfortunately, other places I've been, it's almost a fallback position because there's no way you can treat the literally hundreds and hundreds of acres that some of these species dominate or have presence on. So when you start thinking about the highest and best, the most unique plant sites, and I'm sure North Carolina is probably replete with them, is trying to figure out what applications or what processes do you use or what steps do you have to take to prevent the loss of these things. And sometimes that can be a wide variety of management treatments, access, controlling access. And so it's this whole value thing of how do you let the public enjoy what they want? How do you maintain with a very long viewpoint the species composition that we've got that so many plants, animals, and people hold dear? It's a very, very daunting task to figure out how to get your arms around that.
Roderick, we talked about this a little bit, looking particularly at the federal and state level, but talking about the tensions that exist on management where you have groups that advocate for pristine environment versus those who advocate for public access. Is that a pressure you see politically, attention, when you're dealing with Asheville Parks? Obviously, we know that we have a very active environmental community here. Some areas, you don't have that. Nobody's really talking about it, but you clearly do here. How does that pressure work out as you try to come up with policy in Asheville?
Yeah, it's very challenging in terms of how we manage that. A lot of it is relationship-based, so we try to really sit down and try to look at what's in the best interest of the community moving forward, because it's competing needs, and everyone has a side that they're trying to do what's best for the community, but how do we manage that together to make the space available for everyone? But especially with urbanized areas, having urban forests. We had a property right down the street here, Collier Woods, for instance, that a lot of citizens wanted to see protected because as the city grow up and develop around it, we lose those natural canopy areas, those covered areas. So it puts pressure on, do we develop it, do we not develop it, and how do we protect it? And all the properties can't come off the tax roll, we can't protect everything, but how do we come up with a policy that balances that out? Because we are an environmental community that take the areas very serious in terms of the natural environment and how we sustain it. We have a lot of very outspoken groups and individuals that will let you know right away how serious the community takes those issues. So politically, we haven't really had a lot of political, most of it has just been that development issue, do we develop this or do we keep it natural? And in terms of policy makers, we haven't really had it on that level to where city council is taking a stance and, you know, we're doing this, or are we gonna take this policy, here's how we're gonna address overseeing the lands and managing the properties. It's kind of a case by case. In 2007, the city decided to partner with the county and TPNL and purchase a piece of property called Overlook. It was a $2.7 million purchase. Well, the city didn't have any policy saying this is when we conserve land and this is what we protect it. The county has a policy like that, but city council listened to the citizens and took efforts at that time to preserve it just to keep it pristine and make it available for public use so they can turn it into development hands. So we have more of those type of policy issues than anything else.
Can I add on to that?
Yeah.
And this is great. I'm glad I thought of this. Also with the education that I mentioned earlier in the very first question, I think what folks may be hearing here today is, and one of the things that we tried to get across to folks too, is that there are a lot of different public land owners. And some of these are cities, some of these are municipal, some of these are states, some of these are federal. And then even within those jurisdictions, there are different public land ownerships, but these places have different missions. And I think sometimes we try to put the same mission on everyone. But a state park is not a state game land. And so in our example, a state park has very different goals and the state game land has very different goals. The Great Smoky National Park is a national park. The United States Forest Service is a national forest. And then we've got municipal cities, the parks, you have greenways, you have land conservancies that have various sorts of lands. I could give you a list of about 20 of these things. And it's very important to understand federal wildlife refuges we have in the eastern part of the state, and we're talking about one here with the Bog Refuge. And so all of these have different missions, and we need to really understand those missions and from whence they came. And I think sometimes that's where the confusion lies. The Forest Service tries to be all things to all people. They're a multiple use agency, and they're trying to do some of the wilderness stuff, they're trying to do the timber stuff, and they're trying to do this, and they're trying to get, you know, hunting and all these things, and they've got a tough job to do. And you know, and this is where back in 1987, when we're looking at the Forest Service, we were in favor of a lot of protected areas and things because we thought maybe the pendulum was over here. And now, you know, where the forestry practices are about 800 acres a year out of 1.1 million, from a wildlife perspective, we're seeing another thing. And you know, trying to balance, and Ellen mentioned the balance, it's all about balancing these things here, and they've got a very tough job. So, but these things change and our interests change, and so we may be promoting one thing now, but we were promoting something 20 years ago, and so we're trying to get that pendulum to rest somewhere here. And we know Alan is going to do a great job with this, because this is why we brought him in here, folks. And
No pressure.
And so,
the truth is, we can't strike a balance on this stuff, and it's not the piece of this that's always a little, it's the most difficult part of it. It's the social management of lands, perhaps all of ours.
Yeah.
And so it's the social expectation and desires to do a variety of different things that, particularly in the planning process, that just make it so difficult, because people hold various positions and needs and wants and desires so closely. They just really have a passion for these resources, and so that's the kind of difficult piece of that.
Yeah. One of the things I've observed is that sometimes you will see these passionate debates that will really serve as a proxy for a debate about something else. and we have people with very strong political and philosophical views that are sometimes at odds. A case came up when I was working in Central Florida a few years ago where a flooding ballot measure was put forward. Florida has a lot of those. North Carolina is spared those. If you've been around where crazy things can get on the ballot and they will get passed just because they got on the ballot, some of the things that got passed were out there. So a measure came up on the local ballots saying that they wanted to cap the percentage of land that could be owned publicly. But as you just mentioned, public lands are owned by all kinds of entities. In this particular county in question, we had NASA owning a huge chunk of land. We had the Air Force owning a huge chunk of land. We had protected national seashores. We had protected national forests. We had national parks, state parks, and all kinds of local parks, and certainly all kinds of governmental property in this one area. And there was a huge percentage in this particular county that happened to be publicly owned. And so the real debate wasn't an environmental debate, and it wasn't some of the other issues that we've talked about, management and so on. It was a debate over basically libertarian point of view, saying let's cap the size of government and keep the tax rolls safe, versus a view that said let's have more government control over the lands that need protection. And it was really a philosophical issue, wasn't getting into the science on this. I'm just curious, do we see this kind of debate in North Carolina where there is really a philosophical difference about where we go? I think if there is, it may tilt one way in Asheville, but it may tilt in a very different way in some of our other surrounding counties. What do you guys think?
Well, one, I don't have a really firm grasp on the opinions and thoughts here in North Carolina. There's, at times in the places that I've been, there's often expressed the general concern on the amount of federal land, and this is, I'm just speaking strictly of national forest land, that would occupy a county, let's just say, just as an example. And so, yeah, I think anytime you're looking at additions, people are a little concerned about their ability to do a variety of things and its effect on the tax base, although where we do manage federal property, there are opportunities in payment in lieu of taxes that are provided. And then rural schools, and I'm not sure the status of how that works here in North Carolina, but there are other opportunities to provide funds back to counties. So there is, but there's always kind of a discussion of the amount and those type of things, and their ability to use it in various ways. That one of the tensions that I, and perhaps it's not a tension, one of the opportunities that I see in North Carolina is how much people love this place, the truly unique character it has. And there are just a lot of folks that want to, because Gordon mentioned this earlier, there are people that want to have land in ownership where it's protected and maintained and managed. And so you see a lot of people coming to both state and local and federal working in partnership to acquire land so that they'll be in some type of protective holding for hopefully, for duration. So, I mean, that's kind of what I see at times.
I think at the state level, give you an example, the part of Parks Recreation Trust Fund is funded by the deed tax that you pay when you land transfers. 7 years ago, that funding for land conservation and some of the money we used to purchase some property was shrunk down because it was a dedicated funding source. So when the General Assembly switched, they kind of took that money and started funding some other things. So it wasn't trickling down to the state park system and down to the local level. And it goes back to what you were asking about. It was a philosophical, should money be spent on conserving parkland and doing those types of endeavors? To give you an example of where it really came to head is the city of Raleigh and the state, they were closing down Dorothy Dix Hospital. Mm-hmm. And the philosophical conversation was, does it turn into a city park or does it stay state property and how do we manage that? So that was a big struggle. But there were some other things behind that. It wasn't just about being a park. So I think that's getting at what you're saying about how that has balanced. I think that was the biggest case so far in North Carolina in terms of trying to balance out those competing needs with that.
I was hoping you wouldn't point to me. I'm like, next question. No, it's a very sensitive subject. And, in the Wildlife Commission, we're very sensitive to local situations in all the cases, whether we're dealing with our fish and wildlife regulations or especially in the area of land acquisition. And we've encountered some of those situations in some of the counties, and we either work it out or we don't. If we don't work it out, then we're not doing the land thing. So
You know, it's some of these counties do have a very large percentage of federal or other land ownership, and so, you know, that's just a factor when you're looking at purchasing these lands. But again, you know, I think for us, you know, our success in our conservation efforts over the last many decades, and we've brought a lot of species back, is just, you know, we work with the local citizens and respect the counties and those things there. So we're always very involved with all the players in a particular, each land acquisition. It's like having a baby, each one is different there. And so it depends on many situations. Sometimes there's a lot of public support for a piece of property. They want us to get it. Sometimes we've been in these discussions with the counties and all these things are handled separately to deal with that. But it's not a cookie cutter thing for us.
Well, I'd like to open it up to any questions from the audience. I'm sure there's a wealth of issues I haven't covered. So.
Yeah, it's a shame. I wish we had another hour because there's many challenges we didn't mention.
Yes, sir.
I have a question for Alan regarding this memo of understanding that came out a few months back. The trade-off was establish a national recreation area in return for support of new wilderness area. Anytime you designate a section of forest under a new designation, there are various restrictions, controls, priorities, whatever, that go with the designation. So how does a national recreation area differ from what that land's classified now?
Mr. Crea, I'm sorry, I'm going to have to take a pass on that. I've never worked with one of those systems, and I can't tell you one thing particularly over another. My apologies. I just don't have that experience.
Can I ask a substitute question?
Sure.
It appears I don't have, you know, long history with the management plan that the Forest Service is operating under, but I have been involved with the new one. It seems to me that the North Carolina Wildlife Commission and the Forest Service are cooperating and working much closer together than I have seen in the past. And is that true? And could you comment on that? Maybe Gordon, who's got the long history?
Oh, thanks, Jim.
Yeah.
Long history? No, I'll comment on that for sure. You know, way back, after all of these forests that you see around you back in 1920, around 1920 were cut, and things, and there were little pockets of trees here and there in this whole area. And so, and then coming out of that into the 40s and 50s, wildlife were not doing very, very well for a whole. I mean, there was all sorts of things, unregulated, and lack of regulations and things. And so, but the Wildlife Commission was born in the late 40s, and one of the first things that we did was to have what we call wildlife management areas. And these were little pockets on the United States Forest Service land, and we put someone there 24/7. Back in the days when, you know, all these things about paying people overtime, that didn't matter. These folks lived on there, and this is where the wildlife thrived, because they were protected. And these went through there, and so we were, you know, starting way back, we've had a close association with the Forest Service. 1971 went to a sort of an all game lands approach with the Forest Service, and we divided our folks up and had wildlife crews, and we've been, you know, engaging with our staff actively on the Forest Service land through memorandums of understanding back in 1971. And the wildlife management areas became our bear sanctuaries. And these were places that the bears, you know, hung in there for a number of years, and this is one of the reasons for the success that we've had with the return of the black bear. And so, but our staff are on the Forest Service property. We participate reviewing the timber stuff. We develop joint projects together, and we also are participate at the highest policy levels. And I've been to Washington and all sorts of places with these things. And again, the Forest Service recognizes the state's mandate and authority, you know, to manage the fish and wildlife resources for the citizens of the state, and we recognize them as the federal landowner, and they do the things on the land. And so we've done we work together as good as we can.
It's really amazing the capacity and capability the state has within your organization. It is really impressive. It provides a lot of opportunities to work collaboratively together.
And now that we have a burgeoning and growing non-game section, the wildlife diversity folks, we're doing a lot of the surveys here, trying to find where a lot of these other critters are and so forth. And now this is where we get a lot of the information for the forest plan. And this is why, you know, we want to see some more disturbed areas for wildlife in this go around. And so we're using all this information, you know, to put that together.
Other questions?
You're on the right. A general Forest Service question. I hopefully can help. What is the general emphasis that the Forest Service takes? Is there more of an emphasis on wildlife protection? This is kind of going back to the recreation versus pristine wildlife debate. Or is recreation a priority? Is there a priority that the Forest Service takes in people's access to this land or protection of the pristine, original nature of it, or are you just balancing it?
As Gordon mentioned earlier, we're a multiple use agency trying to provide for a lot of things. And so what I would ask you to think is a Monroe shock absorber. And you're going down this road and you're constantly contracting and expanding to give somebody a steady ride. And I don't know who that somebody is, but it's generally not the agency. We're doing this thing. And so, be it recreation, wilderness, providing materials for industry, be it mining, there's a suite of things this agency is charged with managing. And so, on different national forests, all of us are a little bit different. Be it the ecology, let's just throw the Pisgah Nanahilia. People love this place. They want a mountain bike, they want a hike, they want wilderness, they want all these other uses. We've got timber industry in the country. And so it's trying to do this allocation process of how much are we going to allow where on what kind of lands, and what are the resource values at risk. And so as we go down this road, we're constantly trying to buffer for, be it unique species or opportunities for people to visit. It's trying to keep that thing to where there's opportunities for all without losing some resource values that we just, we collectively can't live without, to be quite honest with you.
Do you base a lot of the decisions on whether recreation is a priority or access based on the local people's opinions and input? Or is it more decided at a further up on based on the possibilities for recreation?
Well, I think what you'll see locally is that, well, access is a big thing everywhere, be it private access or access for recreation. So the forest generally do some level of assessment of what these needs are, be it recreation or other things. And so the decisions on those kind of things will happen locally, either with district rangers or myself. And so you've got assessments of what kind of use do you need, what kind of access do you need. And so it's this whole thing about access versus what cost, both monetarily and ecologically. And so I'm not giving you a really good defined answer. I realize that, because it's kind of highly variable depending on what piece of the earth you're talking about. And so we try to meet the needs at the same time trying to balance out how much use can we apply on the land, once again, this thing.
And there's more and more pressure on public lands to serve a lot of needs. And with some of our primary constituents, which would be the sportsmen and women and wildlife associated recreation birders and things, you know, as the population increases and more land is posted, you got lease fees and all this, more and more folks are turning to the public lands to pursue, you know, hunting and fishing. And then they're getting there, and the game populations are not all that they could be. So, you know, it's a matter of trying to provide these things on limited space that a lot of people are coming into now. And so that's another challenge for us.
And as those spaces get smaller,
right, exactly,
that level of impact is harder to manage.
Yeah, and I don't know if you guys kept up, but last week at City Council we had this exact issue with the Greenway, where, you know, through this, the 29 acres of said the city purchase, trying to develop that greenway where their citizens said, well, we don't want you to have access, so we don't want you to disturb the land, we want you to leave it natural. And the community is saying, we want more greenways, we want connectivity, connectivity. We want to be able to have things that's connecting. And so there's a competing interest, and both have a valid point. I mean, do we protect it or do we use it to help the community grow? So it's a struggle, and especially as we only have limited facilities and availability, the scarcity of resources make it real tough to make those decisions. So you don't have that win-lose situation.
Can I follow up on that? Because we arguably saw a surprising city council race here in the city of Asheville that was highly swayed, if not based on, an addition of a city park.
Exactly.
And again, it goes to, like, is it really the city park we're talking about or another thing? But regardless, it came down to this park. So can you talk about what's next for that piece of land in front of the Silica? And I know there's some folks here from Asheville. Sure.
Correct. That initiative came out of community concern. So it wasn't something that was in the Parks Recreation Master Plan that staff was pushing forward saying, we need to make this a park. It actually was grassroots. It was the community saying, here's a piece of land. We would like to see something other than development on it, and here's what we like. And so that kind of Asheville grassroots, everybody's working together to get something moving, created that momentum. And it lasted for about 2 years of trying to figure out what do we do with the space. So it was very political when it came down to the elections last year. Right now, what we're trying to do is set up a steering committee, working through the planning department, to work with the design center to figure out what is that space and have community dialogue, because everyone feels ownership of that space. There's a lot of invested people that have interest in what happens with that. So we're trying to go through a process now of having everyone at the table and having that community dialogue about, you know, what can this land be used for? Then decide, is it a park, is it something else? But first, you know, what can be accomplished with that piece of property? But it's a very, very emotional issue for the community.
How long do you think it'll take to make that decision about what?
We're starting a steering committee. We started that 3-4 weeks ago with that. So we should be having some community meetings coming up within the next month. So hopefully, I think by December is what the Design Center is hoping to have some type of, you know, what's the use of this space? Because it's a unique situation of what it looks like. So then once you figure out what's that space good for, then you can look at what type of activities you can put on it and what that looks like. Is it a park? Is it open space? Is it some rural? Is it, you know, half? So that's the kind of dialogue they're looking to have.
Going back to something that was said on the previous question, I wanted just to raise a minor issue about federal lands. There is a distinction between national parks and national forests, mm-hmm. and they have different missions.
True.
And so I assume that the answer to the question about, you know, what do you prioritize, it's going to be a little bit different depending on whether you're talking about forests or parks.
Yes, because as you pointed out, the missions are somewhat different.
Yeah.
Our approaches to access or use of land are non-use, just mm-hmm. so that everything is kind of staying in sync with kind of the natural processes. So yeah, you will see this variation across a wide variety of public lands as to how we...
And I guess the state has the same issue. There are state parks and state forests.
And then, and again, that's very, very important to distinguish. And with the national parks, and the U.S. Forest Service, or whether it's game lands or state parks. You know, state parks are you know, they're more recreationally oriented, and you're not going to see hunting there.
Not legally.
Yeah, but although some state parks and some states you do see some of that, but and then you know, active management, you know, the timber industry and forestry and other active things there. You might see some burning. We do a lot of joint projects with the state parks to burn on their properties too. So, but yeah, there can be big differences, yeah. And each one has its own purpose, and this is great. And so, but you know, the national forests are you know, they're working forests, they're multiple use, and you know, they're trying to, like I say, they've got a really complex mission, and you try to find those balances. I think that is the real trick that Mr. Nicholas has to work on.
Right here.
I have two questions. The first actually has to do with these parallel plans. So you've mentioned the greenway planning that is going on. It's been very comprehensive, as well as the forest management plan. And one thing that I have as an Asheville resident, always lived on the interface of the urban area and our expansive wildlife areas and forest service areas. Mm-hmm. is there any connection between these plans? I mean, the Greenway's got how to get from Merriman to downtown, mm-hmm. and then the Forest Service plan, you know, between trails and multiple use, mm-hmm. all those pieces, but how do you get from Merriman to Mount Mitchell? Right. And is there any connection with those two plans, whether it's recreation or whether it's, you know, faunal movement through, you know, I live in the Corner Rock, northern area, and you got this whole other chunk. What's right in the middle of those two? Asheville.
Right.
Is there any connection between those two plans?
Yeah, there's some movement to try to connect it. Right now you have the Mountain to Sea Trails that actually runs from South Asheville all the way through, and it goes through Azalea Park, which is a city park. So we work real close with the federal government in trying to link those up. There's an initiative now to connect Jones Park up on Marion down through Asheville, keep going south. That's a movement at the state level. So I think you're going to see more of that in the future. We're working with the county now to look at how the Greenways plans match up and link up so that you have more connectivity, so that you can actually travel through. And it makes sense to try to do the best you can. Some will be paved, some will be natural. It's going to be a trade-off just based off of the area. But the Mountain to Sea Trail goes all the way through North Carolina. That was the first initiative, and I think you're going to see more of that, the regional type of planning.
And in the forest management plan, is they're also reaching out, or obviously you have a lot of different municipalities you have to reach out to.
Yeah, and I think what you'll have to forgive me, I'm probably not as knowledgeable as I should be on this, but historically what we're doing is we're trying to engage anybody who wants them to come to the table on this, because there's the social economic piece of the forest plan that everybody's paying attention to. So you've got communities like Brevard, you've got Hot Springs, you've got all these communities that are around that are linked either through tourism, direct connectivity, like with Hot Springs, the AT comes through there. So it's all these things that are out there. So we're looking about, well, what resources are these communities using? Is it a discussion around water? Is it a discussion around access, recreation, tourism? And so, yeah, we're looking across these boundaries and trying to see, okay, what type, from the plan standpoint, what are the outputs, opportunities that this plan needs to address? So that either connectivity can be made or what's there is maintained, or looking for new opportunities across a suite of different folks. So, but likewise, the city managers and leaders can always come to the table and present things about, well, this is who we are, where we are, this is the connection we're trying to make. And so in broad general terms, not project specific, the plan would try to wrap that into the discussion about, well, here's an intention to try to do things. Because even without the plan stuff, there's opportunities when you start talking about urban opportunities and environments and what our agency is able to bring to the table. I think, because we were going to talk and get together a little bit, and just say, well, what does that look like?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So. But over the last 10 years, it's been a concentrated, intentful effort to plan more on a regional basis. So we have a lot of opportunities now that, you know, years ago we just missed those low-hanging fruit. So you'll see that a lot more going forward. Just because, you know, with the economy downturn a few years ago, it just forced us to look at different ways to operate and how can we maximize, because the citizens still would like to have the same services provided. So how do we manage that, and how do we maximize it to the fullest?
And part of the 2012 planning rule is the Forest Service has this all lands approach. And so they're looking, and if you look at some of their planning documents from 3 years ago, They're looking at the whole area when they're looking at the forest inventories and all of these other things. So they really, with the new planning process, are to be engaging and considering these things. But you also mentioned the wildland urban interface, the WUI. WU. You have acronyms when you're doing with this public land stuff. I'm sorry, but that is another challenge in the public land management field, because as more and more people pack in around the public areas, that has impacts. And so you start isolating the areas, and then there are certain restrictions on some of the things that you can and can't do. For example, fire. And so you've got a lot of folks around there, you're not going to burn up to the fire. That's going to limit the smoke, and they've got the smoke thing going on there. So that in some cases may take a very important management tool off the table. From a wildlife perspective, when people move in, they bring dogs and cats and all sorts of things that eat bird nests and then all sorts of other things that go on there, and then the raccoons and the possums, and they like the backyards too, and they also eat eggs, by the way. And so then we have a whole host of areas, so your area that we can manage for wildlife, and that we're trying to create these habitats and disturbed habitats and so forth, these areas need to be away from these things that are causing so many of the problems out on the private lands. So that whole wildland urban interface, and they've got a whole document, a forest at the edge. You can look that up on the Forest Service website, Forest at the Edge, and it's talking about all of these things that are around the edges of the forest, and it's a big deal, and we all should be thinking about all of that.
That's one follow-up question. What's the state's wildlife take on the red wolf? And I know it's a national wildlife refuge and it plays into the Croatan a little bit. But I know you want to dodge that.
I can't comment on that really. I've almost never said that in my 34 years, but that's all going down east to my director and all that, and I'm really sorry about that.
Well, I mean, I will say one thing, not particularly on what you guys were saying, but the red wolf, about 5 years ago, when Shula was in office, we actually allocated funds to the Nature Center so that we could house some red wolves.
That's right.
To do that. So we were thankful to be able to be a part of that conversation and offer the facilities to do that.
That's right. I forgot about that.
As you talk about that interface, I'm curious. I know I've lived other places where a big concern, particularly a concern that affected some sensitive species, was ferals. One place I lived in Florida, we had endangered scrub jays, mm-hmm. and they were threatened by the feral cat colonies that some people wanted to protect, and nobody could figure out what the right policy was. It was really a tough issue. I don't know if we have that here in any significant way or not.
We're running into the feral thing in certain places too, and I know down east we've had some places where we've had some endangered birds and things like that. It's very tricky.
Yeah,
very tricky situation, but it's happening, these animals are just doing their thing. They need to eat and so forth, but they're nobody's pets. But they're out there and they can have. And then people do feed them. People might go out there and feed the feral animals, so they're getting this energy source, and so they can have impacts that a normal natural predator would not have, who has to really depend on the food that it catches to eat. And so these are big, and some of these studies, it's amazing impacts that these things that animals can have.
Yes. You all spoke to community-based and relationship-based decision-making, but I was wondering how each of your agencies might be engaging communities that might be politically disenfranchised or disadvantaged. Mm-hmm. How do you make sure that their voices are heard?
I'll start.
Oh, please.
Local level first. historically, we've provided, input sessions. We, put out the flyers, put out the press release, invite the community to come in. Then we'll put up the boards, put the dots up and say, hey, give us some input, give us feedback, then we'll come back and say, here's what you said. And then that creates a dynamic situation between, well, that's not what I put on the board, but that's what he put on the board. So what we're trying to do now is move to more of an engagement type of process where the citizens are leading the process and determining together as a community what they would like to see versus the staff coming back saying, here's your choices. So it's more of engaging across the board, because we do have some communities that don't speak up. And we have some that speak up more, than their fair share. They can speak up for everybody else at the same time. So to balance it out, how do you do that? Because not every area, especially in an urbanized area, not every area is the same. So how do you offer that cross-the-board representation to do that? We're starting things now, what we call Open City Hall. So we're engaging citizens to get on the website, and we'll have different questions they can answer. And we kind of group them together, get a theme going. So we're trying to tie the community together. We call them word clouds, where it's like different thoughts and words put together to form a thought. So we're looking at doing that and being more intentful in our community outreach and getting the public more involved in the process, because that just makes for a better policy and programming.
So we can inch up to the state and then we'll go federal. So we have everybody, this is the day and age of public participation, and the Wildlife Commission does that. I mean, historically, every year in January, we have 9 public hearings, and folks can go there. It's to comment on our regulations, but we have an open session, and we field all sorts of things there. But in related to our public lands, we have gone through a process now of updating our management plans, and so we have had a very intensive process of rewriting all these plans, and it has a huge public involvement part of this. And we just finished this on Green River game land down there. We had 150 or 160 folks show up, and it was all the varieties of uses that you could imagine there. And so, and all of this impacted the plan. So we, and lots of opportunities for public comments and things on that. So we've we're moving our programs into the modern area, and game land is really their wildlife areas. We're encouraging all sorts of other uses, as long as, you know, we're taking care of the wildlife and the hiking and everything, and working with lots of groups. But as far as you mentioned disadvantage and so forth, you know, in our agency, it's the working with the disabled sportsmen and the veterans. And we've got just incredible programs to help the disabled folks get behind some of the gates, using the track chairs, having areas designated. We have special assisted hunts, very, very intensive hunts and things there. But a lot of our focus there is the disabled community. And we've got some great programs, a lot of sportsman participation. The sportsmen, again, rise to the occasion and help us to raise all this money and help us out. So we're very very engaged in that process. And we do the disabled sportsmen with the Forest Service stuff also.
So, pardon me. So related to communities, the stakeholder group is one representation of a group of people that have common interests or ideas or however that works out. So when you think about decision levels, you've got the forest plan as kind of an overarching document that would. That you know, I would eventually end up signing, but so the implementation of that goes down to the ranger districts, or the individual district rangers that will probably have a real beat on communities, who people are, where they reside, and so historically, what I've seen is some really direct outreach, wanting to understand who people are, provide them opportunities for comment, because every decision that we're doing that we make is there's an opportunity for people to weigh in on, if you will. And so making sure that communities that have interest or want to participate or maybe don't know about the particular process, they're informed, so that when if we're going to build trail or we're going to do some type of timber harvest or we're doing something else, people have the opportunity to comment. So it's kind of the cascading thing from a very broad overreaching type document down to where it's like in communities. We're talking, we're providing, there's access on the web, people can come in. And so you can do direct outreach, but sometimes it's hard to get people to engage. I'll be real honest with you. You can go there, but it's sometimes people just think you'll just get a very small subset of folks that will show up on any one particular issue, which is fine. That's the nature of the beast. But we do try to do outreach across kind of a wide variety of different communities to make sure people have the opportunity to be engaged.
Well, one thing that's amazing about the plan, though, is that in the early meetings 3 years ago, these meetings were extremely well attended. I mean, there were places that were 100 people, a lot of local folks coming in there. So there, with the as relation to the forest plan, there's been a lot of local contact and so forth.
And just as you were alluding to, you know, once you finish that plan, it's hard to get people engaged in it. But once you finish it, the ones that weren't engaged come out, and that's where you get
surprised.
Yeah, it's like, we didn't know anything about this. Like, how did you make this decision? So that's our struggle, because you're so close to the government at the local level that everyone has ownership of it. And even if they don't participate in the process, if they don't like the outcome, they're going to attack the process. So we're trying to get in front of that and say, you know, how can we get everybody to the table? Start doing more analysis of, okay, who's not at the table? Like, who do we need to engage? Do we need to have another round versus just having, we're going to have three meetings on this, and then here's when we're going to make the decision about, here's what the plan is coming out, here's when the final draft is coming out. So instead of having those preset timelines, just do it organically as you go through the process so that it gives time for people to come in and come out. It takes a little longer, but... You know, I think that's going to try to get us a better product, at least get more people engaged in the process versus taking chances of just leaving someone out, because they're going to attack the process anyway. So,
good point.
Well, I'm sorry that we can't spend all day talking about this, but maybe they're not. But talking about engagement, that's really why we have these events too. We want people to engage with the news and the issues that are really important. We're really very thankful for those of you to come and talk about some of the top issues that are facing Western North Carolina. Again, thank all of you for coming. These types of events, we're going to be having more of these newsmakers in 2016. The next one is going to be here May 20th. It's going to be on human trafficking. So we're going to be doing lots of different topics this year. These events are also really supported by people like you who provide contributions to our nonprofit. So if y'all are interested in supporting us, we would love to for you to join us. And until next time, thank you very much to all of you.
Thank you.
Thank you.